on your way.
You've become so predictable. It's the beginning of the end, Skinner.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
I'm looking for Dennis Skinner.
What are you talking about?
I've been hunting him for 5 years. And I don't suppose I was the first. This is what he did to me.
Oh, I'm sorry. Didn't mean to frighten you. The door was open, so I came right in.
Can I help you?
Yes, I saw the sign in the shop window down the street. Said you had a room to rent?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, it is. Hi, I'm Carrie Tate.
Dennis Skinner.
Depends how kinky.
Deep inside the killer's head is a special kind of love, a desire so intense it goes way beyond skin deep. Dennis Skinner is on a mission of his own, so horrible, so vengeful, it will make your skin crawl.
Everything's just fine.
No!
Don't fucking lie to me!
Hey everybody, this is Brandon Ford, and welcome to the Blind Rage Podcast. I am always happy to have Tony the Tiger, a.k.a. the Thunder from Down Under, with me. Say hi, Tony.
Hello, Tony, and happy to be here with you again.
Yes, it's been a clusterfuck of fuckery.
Yes.
For this episode.
We'll leave that in our wake.
Yeah. So we are doing Skinner from 1993, another movie in my top 10 favorite slasher movies, along with Eyes of a Stranger, which I did with James, and this one
the Jennifer
stars...
Jason Leigh one.
Yes.
Oh, lovely. Okay.
And this one stars Tracy Lords, Ted Raimi, and Ricky Lake. And if you haven't seen it, and chances are you probably haven't, because about three people have seen this movie, you can find it on Tubi, streaming for free with ads. And
I was going to say, if you haven't seen it, you're me.
Oh, I wasn't going to address that, but we can if you'd like.
Well, I would like to get that off the plate. I'm approaching this as a virgin. I feel so... What was that? 18 years ago.
Yes. Tony's being touched for the very first time, even though he's had a copy of this movie and was given specific instructions to watch it. But he misread those instructions as to say,
don't around watch and it. Do nothing.
Yes, just, you know, twiddle your pubic mound and do nothing while Brandon does all of the research and gets everything in gear. But first,
I was in gear the other day.
All right.
Anyway,
first, I don't even know what that means, but I'm detecting some innuendo. Yes. So yeah, before we get things going, I'm going to get the plugs out of the way, as I always have to. So as per usual, I would like to encourage all the listeners out there to check out my books in both paperback and Kindle editions by going to Amazon.com or the Amazon app on your smartphone, typing in Brandon Ford. You'll find all of my in-print titles as well as my author page. Click follow to receive email notifications every time I have a new release. You can also find my titles in audiobook format by going to audible.com or the Audible app, typing in Brandon Ford. If you don't already, please follow me on Instagram at writer Brandon Ford. I am also on both Twitter and Letterboxd at Brandon Ford. Tony is also on Letterboxd at Tony_the_bear.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to, if you have any questions, comments, concerns, suggestions, critiques, recommendations, please feel free to email me directly at blindragepod81@gmail.com. And last but not least, please don't forget to rate, review, and subscribe. So, do you have anything going on, Tony? Have you seen anything? Is anything cooking? Is anything crack-a-lackin'? Talk to me.
No, I've mainly been watching TV shows at the moment. I've caught up on a Comedy Central show called Roast Battle, I think it's, where just people roast each other. So I've been enjoying that just to de-stress a bit at the end of the days. But And I'm back on my keto diet. That's about as far as my week's gone. How about yourself?
I don't think I've watched anything. No. Did I? Maybe. No, I don't think so. No. I primarily just listen to Howard Stern and podcasts. Now that Howard's back from vacation.
I listened to our Bad Dreams podcast and I enjoyed that again.
Oh. Yeah, I think that is the last episode that I attempted to have background music during the intro. I found a track from the soundtrack on YouTube, and I put that. I don't know if you noticed it, but it's during the background. It's in the background while we're talking at the beginning of the episode. Yes. And then when it stops, we get really loud, and I don't like that. So that's why I don't do that anymore.
Although it was able to cover up the noises of birds around me. In that one. Today it hasn't been too bad. It's not too bad a day here.
Well, that's good. Yeah, because...
Although we did have a miniature earthquake through the night, but nothing too big. We don't get big ones here.
Oh, well, that's... I'm so sorry.
No, that's all right. It's more of a... It's. I didn't even feel it, but... It feels like a big truck's driving past. That's about as bad as it goes.
Tony has no idea that we're having two completely different conversations right now, everybody. but that's okay. I'm trying not to be too current in what I talk about during the introductions because I don't want people to know when it's been recorded. Because, you know, we tend to do these, you know, several weeks in advance, sometimes months. But So we're not going to let anybody know what month or week or year or day we're in right now.
Yeah.
But we are living in the present.
Yes.
As are my idiot neighbors who are always doing some kind of shit in the backyard because they have nothing better to do with their lives. Okay, so since Skinner is on Tubi, I can only assume that it is on Prime because a lot of the time free movies on Tubi are free on Prime without ads. So if you want to watch it there, feel free to do so. Or you can get the Blu-ray, which I believe is released by Severin, which I think is in 2K, came out a few years ago. And although I couldn't see the video, I definitely noticed that the audio is polished up quite a bit because the video transfer in, as a whole, it was not good. It looked pretty bad and it sounded even worse. And there was even an echo in the beginning of the movie. And that has all been eliminated for the Blu-ray. So I was happy that one of my favorite slasher movies got the star treatment, even though nobody seems to like it. Not even the people who've worked on it. For the most part. It's true. But we'll get into that. But for now, let's get started with the movie. So are we ready, Tony?
Yes, I'm got the finger on the cursor.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's Tony. He's always got his finger on the pulse of everything. All right.
On the peace spot of life.
Mm-hmm. All right. Here we go. 3, 2, 1, play. All right. So this was shot I'm assuming 92. And yeah. It came out in, I believe, 93. In 93 in Italy. And I believe France. And then it didn't get released here until 95, straight to video by Apex.
Yeah.
Here we have the introduction of Tracy Lords.
Good Lord.
In one of her first, she did a handful of movies after she quit porn. I think Not of This Earth was her first non-pornographic movie, and then, you know, she got Crybaby with John Waters and started to be taken seriously after that. And I think she
was
really well
in Tommyknockers, and she wasn't excellent.
She was.
Yes.
Did you say she was not excellent?
Well, it was one of those Stephen King TV movies.
Yes, it was not
really
that,
great.
That was not good. That mess. So don't blame Tracy. I do remember she wrote about that in her book about filming that movie because they filmed it in, I think, New Zealand.
Oh, really? Oh,
I have no think idea. So. And there's a picture of her in the book where she's under a waterfall. She said she loved it down there. She had a really good time filming the movie.
Oh, that's cool.
But yeah, so this was written by an Englishman by the name of Paul Hart Wilden. And he previously wrote a movie called Living Doll with Eartha Kitt.
Oh, really? Movie. Oh, interesting.
And that was a movie that was shot in England, but was supposed to be set in New York, and had some American actors, I believe, and some English actors doing American accents, and it was a very unusual hybrid mishmash of things. It was a bit off the wall, but I want to, you know, I want to be careful with what I say because Paul's on my Facebook and something tells me he's going to listen to this.
Did it come across as believable?
No.
No, okay. No. I know Neil Jordan films a lot in Dublin, but makes it look like New York.
Okay, well, I should start off by saying this. I've been a long time fan of this movie. I was a fan of this movie from when I first saw it on video. And I noticed pretty much immediately that it did not have a following at all. It was not reviewed well. It was universally panned. And as I said before, even the people who worked on it did not like it. And I know that because Paul told me. Because I'm a total fanboy, you know, I Facebook stalked him and I sent him.
I just don't want to be here alone, Jeff.
I remember in the video on the VHS.
Yeah, I love you too.
In this scene in particular, there was an insane echo.
I know.
And it sounded really, really shitty. But that's.
Jeff,
the soundtrack is very much improved. So there's Ricky Lake. And I'm going to say this too, because I also did a commentary for this for B-Movie Bonanza. And I remember saying that I thought it was very unusual for her to be doing a movie like this because she was kind of in her prime around here. It was only like 5 years after Hairspray, and it was only a couple of years after Crybaby. And this was a micro-budget movie, and she just struck me as unusual casting. I didn't think that she would be in a movie like this. But after I did that commentary, I saw a documentary on her on YouTube, and she said that she was very much struggling at this time to find roles.
She's kind of typecast. I guess she might have been getting offered the exact same type of roles as she was doing. And
probably.
You'd think any actor or actress would want to sort of expand. I'd imagine this would be her first non-comedy.
I would think so, yeah. But, you know, horror really doesn't scream Ricky Lake. As far as I know, she's never spoken about this movie.
Yeah.
Tracy did not mention it in her book. What is it that you Ricky wrote a book, she didn't mention it. Tracy talked about being in all of John Waters' movies in her book. And
But I guess, maybe with having such a small fan base, there's no one really to talk to about it in the book.
I just don't think she likes it.
Oh, okay.
And there's an interview with Ted on the Blu-ray, and he said that when he does conventions, fans of the movie come up to him with VHS copies of the movie, and I honestly don't believe that. I think he just wanted something to say about, you know, about the movie getting some kind of recognition, but I find it very hard to believe that fans of Skinner have approached him with copies of the movie to sign.
I would think the pluralization.
That's true. But I would think, you know, it would all be Evil Dead or Xena or, you know,
yeah,
fans of such. But the other thing about Paul, yeah, I found him on Facebook, and for several weeks, I basically just harassed him essentially for every single detail I could get about the movie. And as annoying as I more than likely was, he was very, very nice, and he always answered me, and he always answered everything, every nonsensical question that I had, and he even gave me a PDF of the original script, which I read, and I noticed some differences, and one of them was, it was not, the original script was not anywhere near as gory as the final product ended up being, but there was a bit of nudity in it, and a lot of it was Ted's character, and in the opening when he's drags the girl across a concrete floor, I believe, and she's topless, and you see her boobages before she gets strewn up. And in his script, the Dennis character is naked when he does his skinning or his mutilation.
Yeah.
And he was supposed to have some buttockal nudity.
Some from behind nudity.
From behind, yes. And there's Richard Schiff. Richard Schiff is a character actor who has been in a lot of movies, and Paul told me that he is his favorite part of this movie.
Okay.
He really liked his character and the way he's portrayed.
Yeah.
Or he portrayed him. But also, what else did I want to say about that? Yeah, so what happened was when I was talking with Paul back in 2016, and I did an interview with him, a text interview, and you can still find it, I believe, on my B-Movie Bonanza blog. I called it Skinned Deep, an interview with Paul Hart Wilden. And
that's a very apt.
He told me a lot about his fascination. He grew up a big fan of the genre. He's a very avid reader and a huge fan of horror cinema, and is into a wide range of films, and which is interesting because he was telling me about the movies that he grew up watching, and a lot of them are video nasties in the UK, so I don't even know how I got a hold of them.
Okay.
But yeah, he's very much a cinephile and a bibliophile. And so when I first met him or became acquainted with him, he wanted to get this movie out on Blu-ray.
Yeah.
But the 35 millimeter print was lost. And he talks about this on the Blu-ray as well. And it was a search for over 10 years. And he was telling me that's how I knew about the crew not liking the movie, because he contacted pretty much everybody he knew who worked on the movie, and most people had either forgotten about it or didn't even want to talk about it.
Repressed it.
And he even said that he tweeted to Ted about the movie, and Ted said, I don't know if Ted was trying to be snarky or what, but he said, oh, that was just a movie I did to pay my rent.
Did he explain why people hated it so much, like the experience of it?
The crew?
Yes.
Or the fans?
No, the crew.
The crew, I think didn't like it because it was seen as a ripoff of Silence of the Lambs, even though the movie was just coming out when he decided to take a vacation to come to America, and he got a phone call from his mother, who I guess had read his screenplay for Skinner, and she said, there is this novelist who is being interviewed on the radio, and he's talking about this adaptation of his novel, which sounds a lot like your script.
Yeah.
And he took his inspiration from Ed Gein, you know, as Silence of the Lambs did, and Psycho did, and Chainsaw Massacre did, and a ton of other horror movies did. But that's really what inspired Skinner. And, you know, he didn't know anything at all about Silence of the Lambs, but that's what it was constantly compared to in reviews as just a Silence of the Lambs ripoff. Although there's a lot of depth in it. If you look at it from a different lens, and
well, if you remove Silence of the Lambs from the conversation, you can enjoy it.
If you remove that and you try to look deeper and lower your expectations as to,
well, it's got this Ricky Lake just, in it.
Well, if you look at it from a different lens and say not going in expecting more slasher fare, you might see that it is. Dennis is a very complex character, and right here, I think.
Yeah.
He. Is this the part with the faucet?
Yes, his running water into his hand.
Yeah. Throughout the movie, he has this obsession with water. And I didn't get it. I don't think it translated very well to film. I think it would have been something, an element to his character that would have been better if this would have been a novel. But Paul explained it to me, because I did ask him, because I didn't get it. And the way he wrote it was that the Dennis character puts on the skin of the people he kills and transforms into them, because Dennis is always trying to be something or someone else, and water is very easily adaptable in that, say, if you put it in like a container that's the shape, of a star. Exactly. And that's what he was trying to say that Dennis is. He's a creature who can adapt as water can, and that's why he's so fascinated with it.
Well, I mean, if you were to look at it nowadays, it would be like a gender fluidity is water metaphor.
That's true. That's true. So I guess he was ahead of his time with that. And I had no idea where this was shot, because this, to me, especially in certain other areas, it just looks like this gritty Nowheresville industrial town. But it's like actually
Eraserhead was shot. Oh, really? Okay.
It's LA. And I thought that, and mainly because of the factory where he goes to work later, and there's an abandoned building later where he chases this girl, and the train tracks, and all of these things do not scream Los Angeles to me.
Mm-hmm.
And there was, I don't remember which set it was, if it was this house or if it was another location, but it was near Echo Park. And Ted at the time lived about a block and a half away from there, so he would just walk to the set every day.
Yeah.
And he said that had never happened before, you know, while he was shooting in Los Angeles.
Though I was gonna say, it for people who live in Los Angeles, it probably is the most apt representation of what life is like there, as opposed to what the usual Hollywood viewpoint is.
Yeah, if you don't live there, you think it's like, you know, all glitz and glamour and movie stars walking around all the time.
Mm.
It's definitely not supposed to be set there. Because when he has his, when he first meets Ricky Lake's character, Kerry, he said this seems like a nice town, and she said, I wouldn't call a town like this nice. So he wrote this with the intention of it being set in London.
Yeah, why was it not?
He met up with Hammer because he wanted them to produce it. And
MC Hammer. I'm joking.
Yeah, he met up with MC Hammer. He met up with Hammer Films, who in early 90s was not very affluent. Not affluent. What's the word I'm looking for?
Affluent.
They weren't very lucrative.
Yeah.
They weren't as profitable anymore. And so the Hammer studios were reserved to a small office. And he gave the script to whoever the head was, and it was appalled. He said, this is disgusting. I don't want anything to do with this. And so Paul said to him,
they do know their own history, though, don't they?
Yeah, exactly.
Hammer film was very that style back in the day.
Yes, and that's what Paul said to him. And he said, you do realize that's what, you know... This isn't too far detached from the movies that Hammer produced in the 50s and 60s. And whoever this guy was said, well, I wouldn't have been too happy with them at the time either. So, Paul was kind of...
Is this a Psycho reference, by the way?
What?
Where
looking through the people, I would assume so, probably, because like I said, he's very much into the genre, and he decided to take the project to America, and he found this guy who I think it was Three Kid is the name of the production company.
Yeah.
Paul wanted to direct. And this producer or whoever said to him, okay, well, I have the movie for you. Money. We're going to make your movie, but there's only one stipulation. If you sign the contract, it comes with a director. And he said, either you take this deal now, because I'm not finding the money for you again.
Mm.
So Paul decided, you know, to throw caution to the wind, and he signed the contract, and everything was out of his hands at that point. He was in England when this was being shot. He was never on set. He never met anybody. He had no input. He saw a rough cut of the movie when he took a vacation, another vacation to California. And one of the producers, I think his name was Brad Wyman, said, yeah, we're holding a screening for some of the investors if you want to come. And Paul was not even happy with what he saw. And the investors were not happy with what he saw, what they saw. And so the movie had to switch editors several times. They didn't have the money to reshoot, but they were definitely scrambling to make as good a movie as they could with
what
they had. And
well, and editing can definitely do that. Apparently there's a famous story about Annie Hall being quite a shit movie without the editing. Not that I can speak much of it because I haven't actually seen the movie, but that's what I was told by some film student that I was talking with years ago.
Well, that could be said too with Halloween, because before the music was put in, the investors that the movie was shown to hated it because they said this is boring, this is not scary, this is not effective, this is not a good movie at all. And then when the music was put in, it was totally different story.
Yeah.
Also, speaking about music, on the Blu-ray, there's a trailer for the movie that I'd never seen before, and it must have been assembled while the movie was still being put together, because there is a trailer that was on, it was distributed by a small B-movie company called Apex Entertainment, and they put out movies like Ice Cream Man and Jack Frost and Uncle Sam. Not very good movies. But there was a trailer that I'd seen on a VHS, and I think it's on YouTube. But there's also a trailer on the Blu-ray that has different music. It's got like these bells. It's very weird. And there's a lot of alternate takes that aren't in the movie. And there is kind of a grindcore song that's playing in the background, again, that's not in the movie, and it keeps saying just another victim over and over again. So yeah, that was weird.
No looky loose.
And a moment, there's something's about to happen that well, is one of my favorite. Well, I think you can tell that, but it's one of my favorite moments in the movie, and I mentioned it to Paul, and he laughed, and I think he said that Ted improvised it, because it's a line that I always liked. Okay, wait a minute. He told her not to open her eyes, and of course she's gonna open her eyes. This is so weird. Here, listen to what he says.
Told you not to look when I was getting dressed. I haven't talked, you bitch.
Yeah, and when I told him I always loved that line, he just kind of laughed. Or something else that was Oh, and also interestingly, K and B did the effects for this. However, they also didn't show up on set. They just made everything in their shop and it was delivered to the set. They never showed up. But the fact that this micro budget movie got K and B to do the effects is pretty impressive.
You'll have to educate me. Who's K and B?
K and B is a huge special effects group. They've won Academy Awards. Greg Nicotero is in it, and they did like special effects for The Walking Dead and a ton of stuff. They've been around since like the 80s. And then they did the effects for Creepshow 2. I think Wes Craven's New Nightmare, some stuff.
Okay.
They're very, very respectable. Special effects. And also I wanted to say too that in the script, Tracy's character, her name was Vicky, and I thought this was kind of corny, but she, if you notice, she's got scars all over one side of her body from skin grafts.
From Dennis.
Because she escaped him. And he called her Vicky because she was a previous victim. But Yvon Nagy, who directed the movie, was dating Heidi Fleiss at the time.
Ah, yes.
And he changed her name to Heidi. And he put supposedly there's some metaphors regarding their relationship in the movie. That whole thing happened when I was like 10, 11 years old. So I don't really remember, but supposedly he was on the news every night with her. I do remember it being a very, very highly publicized story. I just don't remember the specifics, but I know that she's a little crazy now, and for about
the Hollywood madam,
she had a reality show, I think for the E Network, and she has like all these birds in her house.
Okay,
she's like a crazy bird lady. So yeah, there's that.
What are you doing?
And looking at the water. There was one thing another thing that I had to ask Paul, because I knew that the quality of the VHS that I had was not great, but I didn't think that was the reason why the movie looks the way it does. Because I always thought it had a very unusual look. And it doesn't, to me, it doesn't look like a real movie. So I always assumed that it was either shot on video and later manipulated to look like film, or it was shot on video with 35mm lenses. But he said no. It was all shot in 35mm. So I don't know why it looks the way it does, but it just looks very, very gritty.
Well, I don't know if it means anything, but I looked up Ivan Nodge's film career, and he seems to do a lot more on video than, like, a lot of the filmography had brackets on video type of thing. Yeah. Well, the only movie I took note of was one called All Nude Dicky. So I don't know if you went into more adult filming.
Oh, I would assume that if he's got, you know, that many V's next to his credits, that means he's more than likely doing porn.
Yeah.
Yeah, I really didn't. There's kind of an extended interview. Well, not that long. It's like 20 minutes or something like that. But he's very eccentric, and
yeah,
I really. He was like telling his whole life story, and I didn't care. I just wanted to hear about the movie. And yeah, he was like talking about growing up in Hungary and being a big fan of movies when he was a kid, and he got started in doing extras work and stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know. But again, I didn't care.
he drifted off.
And yeah. I just wanted to hear about the making of this movie, since, you know, there's not really a whole lot known. Because Paul wasn't there, and Tracy isn't talking, Ricky isn't talking. Ted had some things to say. He wasn't very. He didn't really have his interview was only like 14 minutes long, and he just said what I said about living close to the set, and he said working with Tracy, he really liked her. He said she was very, very professional. She always showed up on time, knowing her lines, and she took it very, very seriously. And that doesn't surprise me, because at this time she was really trying to be taken seriously as an actress.
Well, so has she really spoken yet?
What are you talking about? I told you she wrote a book.
No, what I'm saying is her character hasn't really had many lines to speak.
Yes, she has. She has. I've just been yakking nonstop since you started the movie. But she's spoken. She talks to herself a lot. And she had some interaction with Richard Schiff's character.
Richard Schiff.
And in the script, there's a kind of a religious component to her character. She prays a lot, and she reads passages from the Bible that's in her hotel room, and she's kind of asking God to help her find this guy so she can kill him, which is her quest, because she wants revenge.
Bit of the old school Bible.
I guess. Damn it. And but yeah, as I was telling you before, there's a French dub on this Blu-ray, and it's really good. The guy who plays Dennis is really good.
Yeah.
And the woman who does Ricky Lake sounds very French.
Yeah.
Like very much what you think a French woman would sound like. This always kind of grossed me out.
Well, it's not very deep cut. I'm just skinning it. Oh, of course, yeah.
You cook, right?
Yeah, but I've never actually cut up a chicken. But I do cook it with the skin on.
I love it. Yeah, because I don't know anything about cooking, so I was going to ask your opinion if that looked like professional to you.
Well, I guess I have seen shows where they sort of peel back the skin and put stuff under the skin, but I don't know if she's doing chicken or turkey. which is as like shows how little I know. If I can't even define the bird,
Dennis? I thought it was a chicken.
I thought so, but then it had like, because it's got the feet on, it was like, oh, is that chicken feet or turkey feet?
I don't know.
I've never actually seen a chicken, a carcass with the feet left on it.
I don't know.
A carcass. Vote for the carcass.
So he's beginning to get
at her door.
He has a bit of an infatuation with her, and in a way it kind of is reminiscent of Silence of the Lambs, because the Buffalo Bill character was into heavier women, but that was so that he could fit into their skin.
Yeah, whereas in this is just going after prostitutes, isn't he?
Yes. And Ricky's definitely not, she's definitely not as big as thin? She was.
Oh.
Well, she's thinner than she definitely was. A couple years before this, she was in a TV movie called Baby Cakes, and she was really big. I think
she was
that was
the title.
When she was. I think she was at her. That was a, she was at her biggest. She's definitely bigger than she was in Hairspray.
Yep.
No, I always thought it was funny. She told the story as, you know, this is a Hairspray story, but I'm going to tell it anyway. I always thought it was funny because of her character in Hairspray. Here's Tracy's talking.
Yes.
Her character in Hairspray, who is named Tracy, know, she was a dancer and she wanted to be on that show. And she had to do a lot of training, but she had to do more training than everybody, all the other people on the show, because she was supposed to, her character was supposed to be better than everybody. So had to practice twice as hard, and she was dropping pounds like that because of all the dancing she was doing.
Feeding her with candy.
she said Divine was like constantly bringing her Dove bars. because the character, she couldn't lose weight because the character was supposed to be, you know, hefty.
And apparently now all of her hair treatments on the movie are causing her to sort of pull out.
What?
That they had to keep bleaching her hair.
Yeah.
And so now, nowadays her hair is quite stressed and falls out quite easily.
Well, people bleach, women bleach their hair all the time. I've never heard of that.
Yeah.
I don't think
I've heard of it happening. I reckon it started happening with Christina Aguilera at one stage, but.
Well, I've heard that, No, I've heard with certain black hair dye, it can... I don't remember if there's like a certain chemical in it. I don't know if they make it anymore. But... Or if they do, you're not supposed to use it that much. But if it seeps into your scalp, it can be poisonous. And there, you can get a certain disease from it. I don't remember what it's called. Ooh. That was pretty nasty.
Mmm.
Hey, that's it. You were the girl. And if K and B wasn't on the set, I don't know how they did that. Because that was a nasty throat slit.
Oh, I just reckon that they had ink in the knife.
No, I think there was a little more to it than that.
Oh. She's still alive.
This is the most important scene in the movie. Here we're going to find out Dennis's backstory. I don't know if you ever met my father. So listen carefully. Mm-hmm.
Anyway, when my mother died, he insisted on doing my mother's postmortem.
He does this scene really well, too.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, there I was, watching my father cutting her up, doing his slicing, doing his dicing. God, I remember it like it was happening yesterday. Mm-hmm. And he said, he had a smile on his face. I want you to
watch. This is so sickening.
And he reached over and he pulled my mother's face off. Pulled it right off. I was pretty sick to my stomach, as you can imagine. I mean, I was 6 years old.
This was heavily, heavily trimmed, this scene, for the R-rated version.
Well, it's quite graphic.
Yeah.
Right.
And I just stood there, looking at my mother's dead body for hours. Dead. In the box.
But they cut so much of it that they cut his monologue.
Father hadn't done such a good job of sewing her up.
Oh, she shut her eyes.
It doesn't make sense because of the way it was trimmed.
Yeah.
And I reached down and I pulled her face right off. Just like father's. Then walked across to the big mirror father used to keep in his room. And I looked at myself in it. Except that it wasn't me looking back at me. It was my mother. And believe me, at 6 years old, that can really freak you up. You know what I mean?
Okay, one of my favorite lines and my favorite shot in the whole movie is about to come up. Watch when it pulls back. It's so fucking freaky. Isn't that weird?
Oh,
that's so fucking twisted.
Very, romantically as opposed to like homicidally.
Yes.
It looks it's almost done like a love scene.
Kind of. Yeah. Well, why are you letting him? I think it's definitely an erotic experience for him. It's sexually gratifying. And that moment when he licked his lips, that was the moment he was transitioning into that girl.
Yes. He was licking her lips now.
Yeah. I think in some ways this is more twisted than Silence of the Lambs.
Well,
in the best possible way.
And I think personally, I reckon in how it just happened then is that it treated it as it almost sympathizes with the killer more in this one. and it doesn't have scary music. It has more haunting.
Mm. Yeah, and I'm And there are some moments in Silence of the Lambs that are just, you know,
I didn't expect you until later.
Campy and comical, like the famous Goodbye Horses scene.
So where's our house guest?
The thing I never understood.
Which one's that one?
The scene where he gets dressed up and he says, "Would you fuck me? I'd fuck me."
I think that they were iconic scenes.
Yeah, but it's not scary. It's just weird, goofy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I don't know. Good to be happy. Yeah, that's our Dennis. He's a regular Cheshire cat.
I think you got to have the scenes that'll stick with you.
Yeah.
And I think that one stuck with enough audience members.
Oh, yeah.
And I want to tell you never seen a bunch of loons who grin so much. And to this day,
no, I was saying before, it's never explained why Jeff is so angry and why he is so indifferent to Carrie.
Yeah.
But he's just miserable all the time. I always just kind of assumed because he was a truck driver and he was away for weeks at a time that he just wasn't happy with his life. Okay, now the scene that's about to come up here was not in the script. Paul does not like it at all. And apparently it offended a lot of people. And understandably so.
Hmm.
And Ted said in the interview that while they were shooting that this was very difficult for him to do because he felt uncomfortable, and I don't necessarily believe that. I don't think he knew how offensive this is going to be.
Yeah.
25
Well, I think
years.
Also, if it was unscripted, then it really would have required Ted to kind of improv.
Yeah. This would make
it harder in itself as well, is because it's quite racist.
Yes. Especially when he starts rapping. Yes, it's very racially insensitive. And
I think it really goes against the character in general. If his MO was women and suddenly his skinning a work colleague.
Well, he just with Earl.
Hello, are you
all right? It was kind of a dick measuring thing, you know.
Yeah. He could have just cut off his penis.
He could have.
Everything's just fine. And now he's doing red skin.
I like that, though. He was kind of so into the character that he forgot where he was and what he was doing.
Mm.
And then he looked and he saw that he was still wearing the skin.
Mm.
He has a line though that I do kind of like where he says to her, "I'm gonna find you, rip the skin from behind you."
I'm quite sure this was filmed during the day and then just darkened.
Yeah, I think this is day for night. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, this bit
different. That's what it makes it a
I mean, we were talking about. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, without the scene, it would be quite a shorter movie, but I think, yeah, it could have been done without the scene.
Well, I think that this was probably added for more, to add more suspense.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. He's going to start rapping like one of the Fat Boys.
It's like
I don't even
went
know
from
what the hell he's
Texas Chainsaw 1 to Texas Chainsaw 2.
A little.
It's like, oh, now we're doing it for shits and giggles.
And you could, because that mask doesn't even look like Earl at all.
No.
So you could tell that K&B did the prosthetics and everything and brought it, because they didn't mold the actor.
Yeah. But then I don't know what a face would look like once it's been peeled off.
Well, I mean, this, they don't even have the same skin tone.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, we're about to have a... He's still in character. Some doggy abuse here. Oh. Did you hear what he just said?
No, no. Have a hand?
What? When he pulled the arm sleeve off, he called it an Earl sandwich. What you
got for me, bro? Oh, God. That's
and now the dog is eating it.
Yes. It's a bit of cleverness in...
No, but I was going to say, I think that the scene was probably added to bring more of a horrific element to the movie,
yeah.
Because there are some scenes in the script that are kind of dry, and I don't think would have worked.
Yeah.
Like I said, there were some scenes with Tracy's character and she's praying, and there's a subplot with Jeff, who suspects that Dennis and Carrie have something going on, and he follows. Carrie makes him lunch to bring to work. And
yeah.
There's a scene where he's sitting outside and he's eating the sandwich that Carrie had made for him. And Jeff drives up and he sees him through the fence. And Dennis just stands up and smiles and waves at him. And not a whole lot happens. But yeah, that always, from what I remember reading the script, stuck out as one of the
that's right.
Or a couple of the things.
Who's smiling now?
Oh.
Okay. When you said dry, I thought you meant like dry humor, but you just mean like just dramatic
flat
moments of.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
How is not tracking in a lot more blood is a skill.
Oh, shit. And of course, my shit. I'm trying to find my my earbuds, because my AirPods are dying.
Yeah. All right. Do you get to see any malnudity?
No.
Oh, damn it to hell. If it was filmed in Britain, you would.
That's all you're having?
I knew that was probably going to happen, but I decided to use the AirPods anyway. They're supposed to work for 6 hours, and I don't think that was even two, or about two.
I think we could look to see how long a maximum of like 4 hours, but I made more money. I wouldn't be away from
you all the time. Good morning. How you doing, big guy?
He's all happy because he got back.
Yes.
All.
I think it's gonna be a good day today, don't you think?
Yeah. What's gonna be so fucking good about it?
Jeff's cute.
I think I actually think Ted's a bit cute in a...
He is, in a goofy kind of way.
Yeah. I think he brings a... I don't want to say a lightness to the role, but he doesn't play it like a real hard character that you would immediately think, oh, you're a killer. You know?
Well, interesting that you would say that, because he said that in the interview, because he did a bit of research on
psychopaths
versus sociopaths.
And, I didn't realize that there was a big distinction. Yeah,
and he looked a lot at Dahmer at the time, because he was in the news a lot at the time, so he kind of researched how he behaved in his day-to-day life, and nobody who knew him, you know, knew anything. But psychopaths are like the Dennis character in that they hide in plain sight.
What's a trait of a sociopath?
Sociopaths are manipulative or narcissistic. They're genuinely exhausting to be around. And it's very it's very difficult to, and they have no conscience. That's the thing.
Yeah,
and you can they have no conscience. They have no remorse or anything.
I wouldn't worry about old Earl. Heck, you know him. He could be right under our noses.
I'd read about psychopaths, and I was confusing them for sociopaths again. That they're very unempathetic and think they're the top of the world.
Yeah, there's definitely an egomaniacal trait that goes along
in business. Apparently they're far better as gatekeepers to the president than actually being a president. That something about them makes a business collapse.
Well, you missed a bit of a joke there. His boss was looking for Earl, And Dennis said, well, you know, Earl, he can be under our noses and we wouldn't know it. And then he lifted up his bag. Meaning that whatever remained of Earl was in the bag.
Yep, yep. His mustache.
Perhaps. No, I don't think he had a mustache.
No, I couldn't remember. A cleft palate.
Okay, we'll go with that.
He didn't have that at all.
No, I know.
She looks like a gothic version of Carmen Sandiego.
Oh my god.
Like she dresses like one. I swear I'm living in a plane with a red, white, and blues.
All right. Calm down.
Hi, Carrie.
I'm surprised that Ivan didn't name Carrie after Heidi, but I don't know what their relationship was like, if you wanted to give her a nice part or a grisly part.
Same old story.
I think he probably named her Tracy's character because he probably thought that Heidi Fleiss had an obsession toward him.
Oh, okay. But they were together at the time, were they, or was she an ex?
I think when this was shot around 92, and that was when, you know, the whole thing kind of, the bubble kind of burst. So they probably weren't together anymore.
Oh, yeah.
Or they probably had just broken up when the whole scandal happened.
I don't know if you ever read much about Dario Argento, but his wife or his partner was in a lot of the movies that he did.
Yeah, and when she they were
oh, really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
But when they were in happier times, her character was always quite nice. But then towards the end of their marriage, like she was the one that got killed by a monkey.
Yeah, in Phenomena.
Mm.
Daria Nicolodi.
Mm, that's sad. I didn't realize that she died.
Yeah, she died in January. She was in her 70s.
Yeah.
And I don't know if she was Asya's mother or not.
I don't actually reckon, but I can't say for certain.
I think she might have.
Like, she could be by way of aid, like, by their time together.
Yeah, I think she was.
Okay.
I think she was.
I just wanted to tell you that
he has another daughter, and she was in Phenomena in the very beginning.
At the beginning, yes, I heard your saying so.
I mean, I know things will work out for some.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think first, maybe.
So they slept together. She got that dick.
He got under her skin.
He got under her piss flaps.
Yeah. I didn't know if you had that term. That was a joke in primary school. What's the difference between a girl and a carton of milk?
I don't know.
A carton of milk doesn't grow hair in its flaps.
Oh. Well, it might if it's left out too long.
It might get moss.
Maybe.
Poor girl.
But then again, so do piss flaps.
Oh, yeah. That's take a bit of yogurt.
They both get a little moldy.
Hmm.
So.
And I wouldn't want to be near either.
No.
She kind of looks like a homeless drug addict that's dressing like Stevie Nicks.
Oh, my God. So specific. First with the Carmen Sandiego. I'm worried about you. Where have you been? This scene is longer in the script.
Come on, yeah. Don't be like that.
And it's kind of different, too.
They never released an unrated version of the movie?
No, this is the unrated version.
Oh, so even that monologue that he spoke was cut then?
No.
Oh, okay. Oh, good.
No, this is the uncut version. Yep. The R-rated version is very sloppy.
Yep.
You think that the MPAA would give this an R with all of that gore during that skinning scene?
Well, I don't know what the what standards in America are. Desperate to get this guy. I find with some of these older effects, they can be more traumatic than the newer effect. Like, as they're getting started, figuring out how to make flesh look like it's coming off, it can look even grislier. You don't even
know him. I don't need to know him. But I followed you around tonight when you
went down to the river. This guy's in a show called The Good Doctor, which I've never watched.
He's
got that I haven't.
He's in a lot of stuff.
Hmm.
Just like that. But nothing in return. He wants some of them piss flaps.
Come on, be reasonable, huh? Go ahead, kill me. Then you'll never find out. Come on. Don't be so modest.
I know what you're doing. See if that skin graft feels the same.
Ew.
Weren't you saying that some skin graft can be made from foreskin?
Did I say that?
Oh, maybe not. I thought it might have been said on Howard Stern or something, and I feel like I heard it being retold, but I can't remember now.
Yeah, there's a bit of a fight sequence that's in the script, and she does end up jabbing him with the needle, and I think he dies.
Okay.
Dennis?
In the original script, or do you just never see him again in the movie?
In the original script.
Yeah.
But no, you don't see him again for the rest of the movie. That shot of her screaming, I always remember was on the spine of the VHS.
Oh, okay.
It was a little square screen cap of her screaming.
Here's Eddie dying.
Oh, they do show it then.
Well, it's covered in blood and crawling along and dies. This almost reminds me of the Charmed house, but really shit down. Because it's got the bay windows and everything.
This is a fucking sleazy hooker hotel. Rent by the hour.
It's where Tyler Durden would live.
I was just wondering, I should look this up, if Tracy only filmed one porno movie when she was 18. I think it was on her 18th birthday that it was shot. And the rest were, she was underage.
Prior to that. Yeah.
Yes. And
have they all been destroyed?
They have. Well, they were supposed to be, but you can find.
Not that I don't want the FBI knocking at my door.
When it was discovered that she was underage, video stores were raided and all the tapes were confiscated but people still had them because there were people who bought them.
Yeah, yeah.
So there are still copies out there. But the last one that she made before she got caught and the whole thing exploded was called, I think it was called Tracy, I Love You. And yeah. I don't remember how. She talks about it in the book. But she has the rights to it. So nobody can distribute it.
Yeah.
So I wonder if she ever did anything with it.
Read it to me.
I don't think.
Just says sorry. This isn't Carrie's writing.
I don't think she probably destroyed it.
Yeah.
My wife, I want to know about it.
Well, I mean, she seems pretty well adjusted for someone who got into porn as a child.
Run away together. Yeah.
You obviously know him. Tell me what's going on.
You don't want to.
She's very intelligent.
You're talking about my wife. Now you tell me.
I'll find it myself.
You're not going anywhere until you fucking tell me what's going on.
If he has your wife, then it's probably too late already. Tell me where he goes. He never strays.
What are you talking about?
I've been hunting him for 5 years.
That's a revelation here.
I was the first. This is what he did to me.
Oh! Jesus Christ.
It's his hobby. This is what he'll do again if I don't stop. So I want you to tell me. Where does he go? What does he do? I said, tell me.
I don't know. He works in a factory. He's a janitor or something. He cleans. I don't know.
Where?
Where? I don't know.
What's even in the needle?
Morphine. She's
Oh, okay.
She's constantly in pain.
Yep. Because
of the skin grafts. It was kind of fucked up. In the book, she talks about how after the whole scandal was over and she would go out to auditions for regular movies
yeah
and she would be stopped by people at her car wanting her autographs and shoving pictures of her with a dick in her mouth saying, would you sign this for me?
God. And that would be child pornography, wouldn't it? The pictures.
It would be. Yes.
Yeah.
It would be.
What if I refuse?
Don't.
In her first movie that she did after leaving the porn industry was Not of This Earth, and the only way she would get the role was she had to do a nude scene.
Oh,
and I remember
okay.
she said. She just said her boobs. I remember she said in the book, right before they shot it, she said to the crew, take a good hard look, boys, because this is the last time you're ever going to see it. And she never showed her boobs again.
Yeah. Thought she was going to say, don't you want to check my ID? Did her did she create revelation in the porn industry, like where you need to have proof of age and ID.
She did. She had a birth certificate that was given to her.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, she had, and because of that birth certificate, she was able to get a state issued ID.
Yeah. So she was a bit shifty about getting into it. Yeah. Okay. Not that I don't place any blame on her because she was a child. I don't really it was at a certain age when you're not really too responsible for what you're doing.
No. No. I mean, she like, a lot of people in the industry still to this day believe that, you know, she conjured this whole thing and knew exactly like what she was doing. Knew exactly what she was doing the whole time, and she did this as a way to be, you know, carve her path in Hollywood, basically. And there are some people who believe that she turned herself in. Nobody to this day knows how they found out. But somebody called the police and said, you know, this girl's underage, and she was raided, and they found out who she really was. But she ran away from home because she didn't have a good home life. You know, she was she was sexually assaulted by an older boy who she trusted, and her mother's boyfriends were sleazy, and one thing led to another, and she started out, she answered an ad to be a model, and she didn't know that it was nude modeling. And
modeling.
When you're a kid, you don't know how to say, oh no, I'm not doing that.
It's probably a story that a lot of porn actresses have as their background.
But it was also in the 80s too, when drugs were available pretty much everywhere. So, you know, like she said she would go into the bathroom to get ready for a scene, and there would just be lines of coke on the counter.
Yeah.
And she would do that as a way to get through it, basically. She didn't like it, especially when she had to do scenes with Ron Jeremy.
Oh, okay, yeah.
You know what bugs me? So why do you do it? But yeah, and on the Crybaby disc, there's a documentary which talks about how the trial was still going on. And the police were still showing up to talk to her, to try to bring her in, because they wanted her to turn people in.
I remember that. Yeah,
they were hiding her and everything, and she was humiliated. And then they all basically congregated and said, you know, I was arrested for this, I was arrested for that, and it was all just to say it's not just you.
Yeah,
you know. I thought John's was the funniest, though. What were you arrested for? Murder. Yeah, it was him and Pat Moran and a couple of other people. They were all arrested for... it was a close friend of theirs who was killed. And It was all signs pointed to that. They didn't do it, of course.
Yeah.
But they were arrested for murder.
Yeah. So I just, like, I know I'm a bit late to the game, but I just realized that Tracy and Ricky were both in Serial Mum.
Oh, for God's sake. He's still friendly with her.
I'm glad that he, like, and I feel that she as a person suits the John Waters universe. like her personal backstory is almost like a character.
Yeah, like, well, he's interested. He has a fascination with like true crime, you know, and also he had Patty Hearst in all of his movies, yes, too. So,
of course, I didn't realize that she was in all of his movies. That's interesting.
I think she was in everything after From Crybaby On.
Oh, okay, yep.
This kind of drags, this end sequence.
Yeah. Just looking at the camera work, I wasn't sure if maybe what was strange is I feel that a lot of it was handheld, but maybe in the infancy of, like, it's not great handheld.
I don't know if it's that. I would assume that there weren't. I would be very surprised if there were any dolly shots.
Got that.
I don't know if it's that though. I just think the visuals as a whole, it looks just kind of off to me.
It could be like even the lighting, you know, it could be anything.
Maybe it could have been that, yeah.
Sort of making it something that you would know to do better if you're a better director.
Look at you. Lying there. Your guts hanging out of your back in your cheap pea green flea market bargain basement coat.
like an old couple arguing.
They're gonna bring me in, do some tests on me, maybe. And then, a few years from now, maybe, when I get bored through biding my time, they're gonna let me go. You know why? They love people like me. They'll think I'm cured. Doesn't that make you wanna scream? Huh? Doesn't it make you wanna scream? Scream! And it just make you want to rip a good one out.
And that was Skinner.
Skinner!
Mm-hmm.
And you're supposed to go, Superintendent Chalmers.
Hi, Lisa. Hi, Super Nintendo Chalmers.
Well, that was enjoyable.
Yeah.
And I feel that Silence of the Lamb connections are negligible. I think that that's a lazy connection to make.
Yes. Because there really isn't any cannibalism, or anything like that. It's,
Oh, but that was, Anthony was the cannibal.
Yes, but, yes, but it was, what do you call it? Fucking. It was based.
Integral.
They were both based on the. No, they Ed were both. They're both based on Ed Gein. So, yeah.
Although he never killed anyone, did he?
Oh yeah, he did.
Oh, I thought he was just a grave robber who.
No, he killed people.
Okay.
There's a movie from the 70s that I think came out the same year as Chainsaw, interestingly enough, with what's his name? Powers Booth, I think.
Oh, okay.
Called Deranged. And
I remember seeing the cover to that one.
It's the story of Ed Gein, but they changed his name.
Yeah, yeah.
To Ezra Cobb.
Okay.
And instead of calling him Ed, they called him Ez. A lot of people called him Ez, people who knew him. And it's interesting to see, because I always knew him as the guy, the old guy from Home Alone.
Okay, yeah.
And then to see him in a movie like that. But he was still old.
Salt. Yes.
Yeah. He was still pretty fucking old in Deranged. Any hoozles. That was Skinner. And there's no sequel, unfortunately, even though the ending kind of sets it up for one.
No, well, I think it was just more of a social commentary ending that, you know, people love a psychopath or a sociopath. I was reading Paul Hart's filmography, and he did a lot of the 1001 Ways to Die, if you ever watched that show.
No.
That was a silly little... I thought it was fun. I caught a few episodes, but it's just... It's basically, let's say, just like Final Destination, but sillier even.
It's a scripted series?
Yeah, but... it's sort of like a, it's like a air crash investigation show, but it shows some weird ways people have died and then how you can get killed, you know, like, it's been a long time since I watched it, but let's say one of the ways is getting hit by a sledgehammer across the head.
Oh, no.
It will sort of go into the medical background of why you would die from that, you know.
Well, it makes sense that he would be involved in something like that because he's a true crime aficionado.
Yeah. But I was reading that he's still got films coming out, and the next one that he wrote is going to be Gabri Sidibe's movie debut as a director.
And what's that one called?
I wrote it down. Pale Horse.
Pale Horse.
Yes.
Interesting.
So good to see that it's still going.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Though Ivan, no, not at all. I don't think he's really got much on the horizon.
No. And I think the only reason why he got this job was because of his infamy.
Yeah.
And allegedly, I want to say that again. Allegedly, a lot of the movie's budget came allegedly from the mafia.
Oh, okay. I thought you were going to say from Charlie Sheen's contribution to Hardy Flies.
Allegedly, it may have. No, I don't think she had any money. Yeah. She was paying off attorneys left and right.
I watched a documentary a little while ago about, but I cannot remember what it was, but where they're looking at how there was a film production that was shut down because of its connection with the mafia. But...
Well,
I watched a few Netflix documentaries that weren't very, like, I watched one on the Hotel Cecil and I just hated it. But
interestingly enough, the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre was partly funded by the mafia, so okay. Nobody really knows to this day exactly how much money the movie made because of that, because they had to pay people back and stuff.
Well, at least they got a few arms and legs for free.
They did, and if some not kneecaps. A few thumbs. Yeah. They called up Johnny No Thumbs. But they addressed the letter to Johnny No Knees. That's what you gotta do.
Yes.
You're picking up what I'm throwing down?
Like Cheryl and Finn.
All right.
Well, lovely to watch Skinner with you.
Oh, yes.
I enjoyed it thoroughly.
Well, that's good. Yes, yeah. Okay. Well, if you don't have any final thoughts, we're going to put a big, fat bow on this one.
Bow on it. No final thoughts. Just happy to be here again.
All right. Well, thank you for... Thank you so much for coming.
Of course. You'll have to give me a few more minutes and I can come again.
Oh. On that note, I want to thank everybody for listening. And until next time, this is Brandon Ford wishing you all unpleasant dreams.